Ok. Bonjour à tous, merci d'être là. Un immense merci à nos trois participants de ce talk qu'on a baptisé simplement et en référence à l'expo de 2003, Alors la Chine. The challenge of today's Chinese art scene in international museum collections, and of course for Centre Georges Pompidou specifically. So thank you so much, Bernard Blistène, to be with us today, Yong Ma, to be with us today, and if you can maybe, you know, state what you are at Centre Georges Pompidou recently for, and what is your mission. I think everyone will be very happy to know about that. Thank you so much, Jérôme, for moderating this talk, knowing your experience within the Chinese art scene and the international art scene. And before leaving the floor to you guys, again, thank you so much for accepting this talk in your crazy schedules in this crazy week of YAC. At ASIANOW, we're super, super grateful to have you. And I'm sure after this conversation between you three, the audience will have plenty of questions for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Alexandra. So we are delighted to be three of us here. You may know Bernard Blistène, a key figure in the French art scene, director of the Pompidou Center and Museum National du Musée d'Art Moderne, right? And famous for having done many important shows himself, curator, historian, writer, I would say poet as well.
And an opera singer.
Yes, an opera singer. You're more or less an opera singer, something else. And you're Mark?
Sometimes crooner.
So we may have a chance at the end of this speech that he will sing for us, and only here today at ASIANOW.
Of the record.
In the record, a song for you. And Yoma also is a curator in this department of photo recreation and prospective at Musée National d'Art Moderne in collaboration with K11 Art Foundation. He was before curator at M+ in Hong Kong, you know this museum, and curator of this Hong Kong pavilion at the 53rd and 55th Venice Biennale. When I look at both of you, it reminds me when Chen Sen came to my flat in 1984 asking, do you think there is a room for Chinese artists? That question was very surprising to me, and he said, I asked him, why do you ask this question? And he said, have you ever noticed there is no curators in any museum around the world dealing with China? There is no Chinese curators, there is no Chinese art critics, there is no Chinese galleries, there is no Chinese artist in any gallery beside Zhao Wuki. That was in 1984. Of course, now when we look with our perspective, this seems to be prehistory. Things have been very fast, by chance, to reverse the history with no China, with now having the minimum of Chinese or Asian artists now in any cultural project. This is why when Alexandra proposed this beautiful catalogue that you invented at the Pompidou, Alors la Chine, then China, it's kind of a perspective since 2003 when you made that show in which there were Liu Xiaodong, Zhu Tihai, Yan Lei, Song Dong, Wang Jianwei, Yang Fudong, cinema, literature, the first perspective on Chinese contemporary art. What kind of perspective since 2003 you as a director of the museum you see with Chinese contemporary art?
Thank you, Jerome. I guess all of you know that we invited Yong Ma to join Centre Pompidou since a few months. By the way, if you look back at the history of the collection, as I guess you did, you can see that we collected, even quite a long time ago, Chinese traditional art. But all his works have been sent to Musée Guimet, which means something. It means that we considered until the 80s that all these works didn't belong to the history of modernism and have to go to another institution in Paris, which is, as you know, the traditional institution for Asian art in our capital. I was very impressed with that. And as you said, the only one who remained as both Chinese and French was Zhao Wuqi, who, by the way, we didn't appreciate a lot. And something very sad, when he died, all the estate went out of France. We didn't want to consider, you know, because we didn't know how to fix the position to Zhao Wuqi. We didn't want to consider his work. Well, on the other side, don't forget that quite a lot of Chinese artists went to Paris in the 80s. People as Shenzhen, as you say, who didn't come to Paris for political reasons, but for personal reasons. But artists as Wang Du, artists like Wang Ping, and many others were in, well, let's say the mid-80s, les Chinois de Paris, as we say. And until this exhibition, which you described, Alors la Chine, we didn't pay attention to Chinese culture, no more than we paid attention to Russian post-war communist art. And as we say in French, we put both of them in the same bag, dans le même sac, communist culture. And since, well, let's say the end of the 80s, we understood that something has to be done, and thanks to somebody like Jérôme, who is one of the first, no, to tell the truth, who decided to develop something out of his cartoon. And as we, all of us, know and respect in China. So when I took my position 3 years ago, deeply inside what all of us we call globalization, despite the fact that I hate this work, I want to be clear with that, I hate this business work, you know, I considered that we needed to reconstruct, to deconstruct and reconstruct something in another perspective. But I didn't have any people in my team who could professionally give the information and who could be the link or the red thread between the two continents. So, with the support of a friend of mine, a foundation, you know, because I couldn't find any other solution, we decided to invite, you know, Jung to join the Pompidou. To do what? Well, to build both a collection and a program, and to restructure, you know, reframe, reconsider the relation between the two cultures. I went to China 2 times. I spent a long time, the last time in China, something like more than a couple of weeks. I knew some artists from galleries, from anyway, but we didn't do a draft, to be precise, you know, which could fix, you know, a position. So let's say that it is Yong Ma's project, and it is what I do expect from our cooperation. I will do my best to give him some possibilities to curate exhibitions, to develop a collection with the support of France, and keeping always in mind that it doesn't make sense to me, maybe I'm wrong, to start to buy de tout un peu. You know what it means? De tout un peu, well, everything and nothing. So my own expectation will be to be quite focused, quite precise on different situations which can be specific or which can establish as a connection, a dialogue, a dialectic between the two cultures.
Yoma, you have just been hired to one of the most important contemporary art institutions in the world. How someone like you, as a young curator, to be all of a sudden to come from Hong Kong and arrive in Paris and immediately work with Christine Massel, Alors la Chine, and all these elephant institutions, because you come from a non-existing yet institution which is still building, to arrive in one of them. You could have been invited to the MoMA or Pompidou with the same kind of level. So how do you feel to be part of this historical and contemporary important place? It must be a big jump.
Do I stay?
Yes, please. And listen, and listen if you can.
I'm just going to be honest anyway, so please stay if you want. I think you're right. It is a big jump in that sense, but also at the same time, I think, well, I need to say something about M+ as well. You know, I think that kind of, although M+ still doesn't have building, like the team's been there for, I mean, I've been with them for 5 years. You know, so the team's been there for about 5 years, and you know, the curatorial team is a pretty great team, I think, you know, and that gave me a really good sort of foundation in terms of exploring my work with the Pompidou. And I think, you know, actually often people ask me the questions, well, over the past 2 months or so, you know, what's it like, how different is it? I think, you know, ultimately, most, at least with M+, you know, the ambition is to become a large institution like the Pompidou, like the MoMA. So, in terms
of... They will be, because their collection is already amazing. But...
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, in terms of the day-to-day operation, in terms of being a curator, doing research, doing proposals, you know, in terms of procedure, I think actually quite similar in that regard. So, yes, in a way, I think in terms of my career, yes, it's a big jump, but in terms of my day-to-day kind of work, I don't think so, to be quite honest.
Just to go back to what I said with Chen Sen, you're going to be somehow in the West one of the first Chinese curator in one of these institutions. So it's something, it's not just as nothing, a little is of, you know, you know, it's an important moment too, that you are part of that institution, you know. Mm-hmm. I think it shows a change, it shows the new step of the history.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely right, you know, but I think I would like to sort of shift the focus a little bit, you know, not just focusing on myself, you know. I think it's a bigger picture in terms of many other institutions like the Pompidou starting to realize the fact that we were talking about multiple art histories, so not just one perspective. And I think that is sort of quite obvious in terms of some other, like Tate, you know, they've been doing something not exactly the same.
Oh, good, and he's doing as well.
Yeah, exactly. So expanding the collection and try to understand what this idea of multiple modernities actually means, you know. And I think it's great that I'm being able to contribute to that, you know, through a great platform like the Pompidou.
But I must say something. We've built this multiple histories for a while, but we rejected it. If you look back to the history of the collection, which is, of course, you reflect that the history of French culture, what happened to France, you know, and if you dig inside the collection, as I guess you started to do, you see that this collection is multiple. But we didn't use it as is, and we rejected it. As I said, with Chinese culture, and of course, we don't have what we have to collect. But anyway, it makes sense to think that quite a lot of the works which have been acquired in the 30s, and the 30s, almost a century ago, had been rejected, you know, to another institution, because we couldn't do anything, we couldn't, let's say, reframe the narrative as we were supposed to do. But we cannot say that we are just starting to do something. We did, maybe in disorder, or with other kinds of perspective, but we did, not only with China. We did because it's also the colonial past, and anyway, quite a lot of things which you know and which I don't have to describe. But we did, but we didn't know what to do with it.
Your Marcel Duchamp at this moment shows exactly the real face of France. That's why, which is another change as well, because as you said, for a long time our history of exhibitions or collections were mostly white power and no internationally oriented. And that's changed by chance recently in most places. But you have a 3 years mission, right?
Six, if you want.
Good.
I think I should sort of negotiate our contract here.
you should immediately.
After six, there is a discount.
And Alexandra has a tape. Alexandra has a tape, so if there's a problem, you will ask her. Claude is on the right side as well, so we could help. Because I was concerned, because 3 years in a big institution, it's often not enough, because you know the rhythm of projects and things like this, difficult to implement.
That's what I think for myself.
Are you starting to
think about 12, yes.
To prepare your song.
Always.
No, but I know, I think that was right. I mean, 3 years, I mean, the term is a starting point, you know, we'll see how things evolve over time, and then, you know, it could be longer, much longer.
It has to be longer. You can't, well, I guess it takes a couple of years to understand and to fix something. I guess, either for you or me, you know, so it must be longer, but you will take your decision, and I will approve it, of course.
Your partnership with Kelevet, sorry, is kind of collaboration on both parts of the world, if I understood properly. So, which form will take these exchanges between France and China? So this is something I wanted to raise to both of you, between a national French institution and a private Chinese institution in Hong Kong. How you will develop this collaboration, which form it will take, what will be done for the French scene and what will be done for the Chinese scene, how you will develop and invent this new collaboration?
I think for me, that's from my point of view anyway, that the most important part at the moment is to do my research and try to expand the collection of Chinese holding. I think that's the first step. And then, of course, also with programming as well, I think that's important. But what I kind of want to say is that I think I'm lucky, I'm of a generation of curators that started to think of sort of trying to understand the conditions of the world we live in today from a slightly different point of view. So I'm hoping that, you know, whatever program that I'm going to produce in the future is not going to be understood as the Chinese program. I'm hoping that it can fit into a larger narrative in dialogue with the rest of the collection perhaps, but also in dialogue with larger art history as well. I think that's the important part. I kind of really try to, hopefully I can move away from this more sort of just regional focus.
It's great because it's exactly the focus of your generation of artists who don't want to be just seen as Chinese. They want us to be seen as artists or curators.
I do agree with that. The first thing which I like to say, I never met such a simple and free guy as Adrian Chang. And I want to be clear with that. And it's important to tell it in front of you. I didn't have... I was just telling the truth.
Adrian wants to
somewhere.
No, but anyway, it's important because I heard from different people, well, you take this guy because he will be like an agent double, between, you know, some kinds of Jean Le Carré, you know, between, you know, Centre Pompidou and Adrian Chang. It's not true at all. And we must be very clear with that. When Adrian said to me, I would like to support, you know, an art historian or a curator at Centre Pompidou, he didn't ask me for anything except to do what we wanted to do. So I've been talking with my team, and especially with Christine Massel, and we selected a few people, we had some interviews, and finally, we are very lucky to invite, you know, Jung, but I didn't have any pressure. Keep it in mind, no pressure at all. It has to be clear and it has to be said. So I totally agree, of course, with what you say. It's not the Chinese in Paris, like, you know, something like, I don't know, some traveler.
Exoticism.
By the way, if you answer in terms of what you would like to say, maybe you can explain what, for example, you would like to do between Chinese and African art. It can be an example.
Yeah, I think there's one of the projects being developed with a colleague at the department at the moment, which is a project focusing on the relationships that's been developed between China and Africa as we speak. And that is kind of rather interesting. Of course, I mean, we are trying to look into slightly more historical links. Well, you know, there have been actually quite a lot of sort of migration between China and Africa since last century, and but you know, as I think most of us know, like that's been intensified over the last 10 or so years, you know, quite a lot of Chinese investment in Africa and vice versa.
Huge one.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, massive, and I'm talking not talking about just private investment, but actually state kind of level investment as well. And there are actually quite a lot of African merchants working and living in China at the moment as well. So we're trying to explore that, and you know, through how art language has sort of been developed as well around that, and we're hoping to look into. I think the lucky thing about being able to work with Pompidou or at Pompidou is that, you know, because the museum just not just for art but also the design and architecture, all these kind of different elements as well. So design, especially product design, might become actually quite an important part of this project that we've been sort of looking into exploring.
It's a very tricky issue between Africa and China, because often people forget the huge relationship there is, especially nowadays, even if before it was a little complicated between those two territories. But nowadays it's completely different, it's changing completely.
It's financial, it's artistic, and of course also it's political in terms of the relationship and how we can sort of explore that from a slightly different point of view. I think that's rather interesting.
As you mentioned, the pluridisciplinarity of Centre Pompidou, so it seems to me that it can be really a target to do something in different disciplines of Centre Pompidou. It depends what you look for, what are your researches, but it seems to me that, as you said, for example, as you know, we have this huge collection of architecture, and we do a lot of things in architecture. The target is not to cover all over the world, you know, and to cover everything, because if you do that, you become totally lost and it doesn't make sense. It's maybe to be more precise. And anyway, if you look at, for example, I would like to give two simple examples. We acquired, as you know, before you arrived, this huge Shenzhen late piece, Beyond the Vulnerability, the one which has been made between, you know, all the threads which Shen had all over the world, you know. And this piece is definitely a dialogue between Chinese culture and South American culture. Mm-hmm. And the piece itself, which is a great piece, is really as the result of this dialogue. And I'd like to give another example. As you know, we are very lucky to work with also Catherine David. Catherine David is in my team. When I arrived, when I took my position at Centre Pompidou, the first lady I called was Catherine. She is like my sister, and I said to Catherine, as you know, forever, and I told him we need to work together. And she went back immediately to Centre Pompidou, where we do work together. And Catherine, for example, described me one piece from Wang Yan Wai. Do I
spell correctly. The title of the piece is The Morning Time Disappeared, which is one work from 2014. If you look at the piece, what is the piece? It's between Kafka and, let's say, like a China's dream or something like that. It makes sense, because you're definitely over this exoticism, which could be a real danger.
Yeah, I mean, with this Wang Zhongwei piece, what's more, and I think that's quite interesting, I think it fits into what you were just saying, it's an intersection between cinema and theatre as well, so it's cross over a lot of different elements, and I think that kind of representation of what we're trying to do as well.
He's really an iconic figure since 20 years, Wang Zhongwei, playing on this cinema, theatre, visual arts, performance.
I visited him when I was in China, you know, I saw the props, and I didn't know exactly how
he could...
Yes, definitely. But to me, when Catherine talked to me about the artist, we've seen all these films, and anyway, so we thought that it was as an answer to some kinds of questions which we address.
In Africa and China, which I found very fascinating, but what do you have in mind to do back to China? What would you do, you as yourself, what would you do in China?
Well, at the moment, to be quite honest, I think the focus is really working at the Pompidou. I think I guess your question is, would I be able to contribute my experience? Is that what you think?
Wants to know what you're going to do later.
Yeah.
What am I going to do later?
Maybe I'm going to China.
Maybe I'm going to Banaz moving to China, I don't know.
He's ready. I can see. You're making as well another collaboration with another foundation, Mao Jihong Arts Foundation. So, what are you developing through this foundation? So another program, another collaboration, another partnership?
Yeah. Mr. Mao, who I respect a lot.
He's a big entrepreneur.
I think so, yes. As I am. Yeah. Anyway.
I didn't know this side of entrepreneur.
So he went, we went to China, we visited him, and he went to Paris, and he said that he would like to work with Catherine, but on quite little formats, and that he would like to mix and to connect, you know, different kinds of disciplines as literature, philosophy, and anyway, inside his different corners. In his huge mall. He's extremely clever. And Catherine David decided to propose him to develop some small, you know, formats. Not big exhibitions or I don't know what blockbuster things. To connect and to establish as a cultural dialogue between Chinese people and French culture, and it supposes to start the following months.
Will you collaborate with the program? Yeah. Because it would be very interesting if you could collaborate with Catherine, who is a key figure and
exactly,
very, very specialized, she has a very wide vision on the Middle East, particularly, of course, global one, but she has a really big implication in that territory, so it would be very interesting for you to dialogue, share, maybe experiment with or something.
She has a political, you know, philosophy, which I guess such great institutions as Pompidou have really to keep in mind.
Yeah, I mean, one of the sort of many privileges that I've got with this job is to be able to work with people like Catherine David. Itself, of course, you know. So, yeah, that's
me?
Definitely. And Bernard, but I see you all the time, so it's okay.
This is something quite unique because we all knew the model of the Pompidou Center has been the first ever interdisciplinary model of institution to put all together everything. And what Bernard is trying to do now is to put down all the walls that have been progressively within the year. Whatever people try to still collaborate, people still build walls. So it's complicated. So I think you can be as well be one of his helpers to keep destroying the walls in between photography, architecture, the design, everything, and makes it transversal project within the
Well, I mean, I hope so, and I think, you know, that actually sort of quite interesting you mentioned that, you know, because with M+, I mean, that was also the intention as well, so I, you know, I had some experience in that area in a way. But I think what I want to mention also is, whatever I'm going to do, I think I'm actually just contributing to part of the story and the history, because it started a long time ago with Pompidou. You know, I mean, it was one of the first Western large art institutions to have contemporary artists from non-Western backgrounds in like groundbreaking exhibitions. You know, Hong Yongping, Nanjing Tang, you know, they came to Paris because of Pompidou. You know, so I'm just hoping I could actually help to carry on that conversation, you know, so.
I would love to know, because you celebrated a few days ago the Marcel Duchamp Prize, where celebrating the importance, the dynamic of Paris and France, like you do here with ASIANOW. What is your perspective, Ma, on what we do here, what France mean nowadays in the international game and dialogue? Then we will ask.
And
BB. Yeah, BB.
I wasn't expecting that. In terms of the international dialogue.
No, because we always ourselves speak about ourselves. So it's better for me to always ask friends from outside, how do you think we are? What do we do? Are we still as good as we think we are? What are our weak points? What are our strong points? It's always better to ask friends, neighbors to look at your house.
I think, if, in all honesty, I think with, again, I mean, using Pompidou as example, and you know, I think we sort of mentioned quite a lot of that already, that you know, it has been trying and exploring the idea of this kind of multiple histories. But also the issue is there are often gaps. So, you know, someone started it and then got dropped. And I think the most important thing is actually to be consistent in terms of that vision and perspective and try to carry that out, you know, not just doing one show, one program, or one piece of work in the collection. It is actually, I think, a much larger strategy for the whole institution to maintain it, and that is important as a vision.
Bernard, maybe.
I totally agree with what you say. The question is, as I tried to say, not to decide to cover everything everywhere. So you become really stupid, and you become totally lost if you try to do that. But to fix the position. But I agree with you. We started to do that quite a long time ago, but we didn't do anything. Is it? I don't know if we are good, but I do know that we are not worse than the others. It seems to me that the Centre Pompidou gives really quite a lot of possibilities in terms of collection, in terms of team, in terms of diversity of disciplines, and I have to say, in terms of energy. So the question is now, as you say, to fix something and to dig and to develop something which can be what? Which can be as, well, let's say, an historical and political statement. We do know that we live in this multiplicity. We do know that we do not belong anymore to modernism. But to, well, let's say, postmodernism. What does it mean? What can we do with that? How can we articulate something? By the way, if you look at the collection, it's easy to follow as a link from the very beginning of the century until, let's say, the 70s. And after the 70s, something doesn't fit. You don't know how to articulate it, you know. What does it mean? And how could you develop something and bring something in another physical, mental dimension that's, well, let's say the expectation.
Well, it's a very good remark, because since
I think so.
The movements have been exploding at the end of the 70s, and it's more like an individualist program and approach for art. How would you like also you to show that diversity in this hyper-individual world in which we are living in, with a new generation? Will you find a new way of showing that? Will you develop something different? How will you improve what we all have done before?
Well, to be clear, my answer will be in the diversity of what you do. Have a cut. What do we do? Actually, we have Jean-Luc Moulin, as a French artist, exhibition. We have also this P. Marcel Duchamp, which I decided to bring back to Centre Pompidou to develop something on a larger scale, and which is mixing artists of, I hate the word, diversity. Ulla von Hammenburg, it's ugly, but anyway, it's almost clear. Ulla von Hammenburg is German. Ito Barada spent her life between the States and Morocco. Barthélemy Togo is coming from Cameroon. And Kader Attia was born in France, but his family is from North Africa. And these four artists, and please, trust me, I try to know what I do. I try. These four artists, you know, belong to what? Belong to the complexity. I don't want to say that they belong to any kind of geography, I don't. But they belong to the complexity of, let's say, our postmodern country. If you get up, what do you have? You have a small exhibition on André Breton, who, as you know, has been so close to, who traveled a lot in his life, quite a lot, and who's been, for example, in relation to Egypt. So we have this fantastic exhibition, which we opened 2 days ago, about surrealism in Egypt, which is a survey about what happened during Farouk until Nasser, let's say between the 30s and the 50s. So it's a new paradigm. It's how to reconsider what we call surrealism. And if you get on the sixth floor, you have this Beat Generation exhibition, which is crossing disciplines between people who came from everywhere and who went, let's say, everywhere and nowhere. Yeah, everywhere and nowhere. So anyway, all the things all together, you know, can give different perspectives and different ways of thinking.
Yeah, I think, well, on top of that, I think, you know, what I believe is the fact that, you know, often with public institutions, we talked about, you know, relevance, you know, what is relevant to the public, what is relevant to the audience. But I think we often forget the fact that a lot of artists today, and I mean, it's kind of evident if you just go around the fair here, you know, a lot of the ideas and subject matters they are trying to investigate are quite universal. And also the fact that I think we often don't focus enough in terms of the artist's language and forms and how universal that is. You know, like those are the really, so for me, important qualities in terms of trying to speak to a larger public.
Maybe one of the last things before we go to the questions, maybe is we have a lot of things to ask to these two amazing figure here. There is still the idea to have maybe an antenna of the Pompidou Center in China. It was the project started 10 years ago somehow, and it seems to be reactivated today. So where are you with this? This project, and you choose China as the first antenna somehow outside of France. So why China, and where are you with this project?
Well, as you know, something has been started quite a long time ago. Let's say more than, as you say, 10 years ago in Shanghai, and never happened. For why? Maybe for political reasons, the complexity of the relations between China's administration, I have to say, and the French administration. So my wish is definitely to try to mix public and private, because I believe in it. So we are actually trying to find some location in Shanghai. To be frank, until my last trip, I didn't know what to do. And I remembered, Jerome, talking with you about the fact that I didn't know if we had to go to Shanghai or to Beijing. Maybe we are wrong, I don't know, but we decided for different kinds of reasons to go to Shanghai. Maybe we are wrong in terms of artistic art scene, in terms of, I don't know, something new. Maybe we are tempted to go somewhere where we feel closer to Occidental culture than being in Beijing, where
there is a long history, as we all know, in Shanghai. And anyway,
so where do we are? We try, as you know, to find, and it seems to me it's going well. I had 2 days ago a strong meeting about it, and to develop something in Shanghai, well, in 2019, between 2019 and 2020, in the district of Pudong, in Shanghai, in a huge building, which is actually under construction. I don't want to give you more information. But anyway, it seems to me that it is going well. The question will be, to do what?
That was my next question, Bernard.
You said to me that this was the last one.
That was always the last of the last.
Ask to Jung to answer.
Well, I think I know as much as you do about this project at this moment. I guess we will wait and see. I mean, if we find out more about it later.
The question will be definitely to find something specific. And of course, I will need you, if you wish, to do that. Because to me, it doesn't make sense just to bring some masterpieces from our collection, you know. Once again, some neocolonialism, you know, you come with your stuff, you know, but to find something else. But it seems to me that as soon as we signed for the building, as we are actually trying to do, as soon as we find the money, which I guess, cross fingers, it seems to me we did, well, we'll have to work.
That will be instrumental again for China, and thank you very much, Bernard, and the Pompidou, and to Yomba as well, for giving us this information, because that would be very important in China that such an institution come there and bring all the savoir-faire and all the details and the history and everything to China. So thank you very much. If you have any questions here, and I'm sure there is many, especially in the back, normally there is never...
I just want to know maybe for next 2 or 3 years, and which artist the Centre Pompidou like to collection for the...
A couple of weeks ago, you know, Yoma gave a talk for the team at Centre Pompidou to explain what he would like to do. And as far as I trust him, he will answer to your question.
Well, as far as, at least from my point of view, I don't think I can name any names at this moment.
You can talk about a one-man show, which you like.
Yeah, we're looking into the possibility of doing a solo show sometime soon in the future, hopefully. But no, there are a few proposals being floated about at the moment, so it's not 100% confirmed yet. And in terms of collection, I think, you know, there are some key areas that I would like to look into, but in terms of giving names, I don't think that's possible. I'm sorry about that.
I have to say that we started to make some research, and for example, as you know, and it's, let's say, almost obvious, we started to go back to, let's say, the stars group, you know, and to know what we are able to do to collect major works. As for example, we acquired, you know, Wang Keping, but one piece is maybe not enough and doesn't make sense. I do believe that it makes sense to collect, you know, when you respect, when you like an artist, more than one work, and even to see, to show how the diversity, you know, of what he does can be reflected in the collection. So let's say that, and I don't want to say anything more, but that we considered together that we needed to go back to this key point of Chinese contemporary art history and to develop up to date, you know, different perspectives.
Is there any other question? In the back? Or in the front?
Thank you, Jerome. I would like to ask you, what you think of the place which can be for, which could be for ASIANOW in your purpose of preparing the future of the knowledge of Asian art, and not especially Chinese art, but also Asian art in Pompidou or other museum. Is it an important place or secondary place? Or what do you think?
Well, it was definitely not secondary, I mean, I can tell you that, otherwise I wouldn't be sitting here at all. You know, I think, you know, I mean, when I first started talking with Bernard and Christine and the team in Pompidou, I think, you know, of course, the mandate is to be focused on Chinese contemporary art. But I think, you know, over time, I think hopefully in the future, I would like to expand a bit as well in terms of other parts of Asia. I think that's important. And I think because my work over the past decade also has been actually with a lot of other Asian artists as well, so hopefully I can bring that into the museum and expand the collection and program. And you know, I mean, also I think when we talk about Chinese contemporary, I mean the I think everyone has a slightly different understanding of it. For me, it's not just mainland China. It's Taiwan, it's Hong Kong, it's overseas Chinese, Singaporean, it's Malaysian, it's the Indonesian. So I think, you know, I mean, we need to take a slightly more expansive view on that as well.
I hope so, you know, and I would like to get your advice about what we do, well, let's say, with other artists. And, well, don't forget that the Pompidou team is extremely diverse. Huh? We have a German curator, a Polish curator, an American curator. We have curators from all over the world, you know. So it doesn't make sense to decide that because of the fact that you're Chinese, you will spend all your life, you know, under the umbrella of Chinese culture. It's totally boring. Either you believe in globalization, or another word, whatever, the multiple, let's say multiple, you know, more intellectual. Some kinds of, you know, multiple.
The multicultural world.
The multicultural world, you know, something like that. So anyway, multitude, as we said, you know. Or you don't, but if you believe in it, it makes sense to ask too young to be one of the members of the team and to develop in, you know, a different perspectives. Of course.
Another question in the front.
Besides the acquisitions policy that might change slightly and evolve and towards more important acquisitions in terms of Chinese artists and Asian artists, do you have in mind, without revealing, you know, too many names, but at least like exhibitions or some kind of, you know, just giving to the public more visibility on this specific scenes in Asia? Do you have any like big solo show or anything else in mind to,
without naming names, I think, you have a group of Chinese artists that are being considered as part of the post-internet as well, which is a much more international term. And there are the artists that are in the sort of mid to late 20s, early 30s perhaps even, that are very active on the international stage. You see them in many biennials and all that. And of course, that's an area I would like to sort of look into and see whether I'll be able to work with them in the future, the reason I'm sort of mentioning the post-internet generation from a Chinese kind of point of view is that they are using a language, again, that is universal, a language for symbols and motives that actually can be understood across the world. And I think that's kind of important in terms of reflecting what we're thinking as well.
Well, on my side, I don't know if it's universal, as you say, because I believe in specificities of artists inside their own culture. But it seems to me that the question is to try to select artists who can question the universality of the world, despite the fact that they themselves, are totally under, of course, the spirit of their own culture. Though we cannot give you names, and I tell you why, Alexandra, because we didn't talk to the artists themselves. And as you know, we need to talk to the artists before we talk to you. But something else which I'd like to say, on the other side, I just signed with the Grand Palais, and I guess maybe you don't know that. Once a year we do a large exhibition at the Grand Palais, okay? It's like an agreement, I like to do that. And we signed something which will be art under communism. So it will be a huge survey which will mix Chinese, Russian, and other culture, to build as a major statement about art and their communism. But you can tell me, but Bernard, China is still under communism.
Well, some people say that France become communist and China become capitalist. So we have to be very.
But anyway, to summarize, what happened with some kinds of iconography, representations, which I guess the communist image, celebration of the chief, the crowd and the mass and all the things, And I was very impressed when I have seen some of these works in some private collections in China. Yes. And would like to do something, a major exhibition, which will consider all these different.
The Louvre Museum has a very big collection of what you're mentioning.
That this is where I've seen quite a lot of amazing works. It is something which, in another side, will be, let's say, the counter example of what we would like to do inside of Pompidou. But to me, it makes sense to look at it.
Question in the crowd, in the back.
It was like 10 years ago when the Pompidou made this big exhibition in Alors la Chine. So we talk a lot about Chinese artists, and there were lots of Chinese among the top 10 artists. But it seems that recently we don't, for the general public, the knowledge about the young emerging scene is not so present in France or in Europe. How is it so? Is it like a trend that has gone, or is it more for the people in the know? But it seems, for the general audience, that what is happening on the emerging Chinese artist scene is not so talked about here, but not here, obviously not here in this exhibition, but in general.
I don't see like you. I see the opposite. I think this is maybe the first generation that started internationally wise and not started in China. If you look at all the new generation, his generation born in the 80s, most of the one that has started 5 years ago, 10 years ago in China, they are already having international galleries, they are having solo shows in institutions in America, in Germany, and everywhere. So they're more existing, not as a group. They don't want to be part of a Chinese, another Chinese exhibition and all that. They try to resist as much as they can, but they exist by themselves, by their work. So they are mixed with other artists. So you, even White Cube in London has already Russian Yu and show other artists of the generation. And many of this kind of galleries are, at this moment, negotiating with that generation shows for the future here and there in the world. You know, Alvin Reichardt show Shu Chu, for example, in different of our places. So if you look properly, the new generation is already here.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, actually. I don't think that is the case, that, you know, the emergency is not being sort of discussed or talked about elsewhere. I think actually it's more so than before. You know, I mean, it's just because it's not been grouped or labeled as one thing. And also perhaps it's because it's not been talked about by, you know, some mainstream media from more sort of political point of view. I don't know whether that's what you were referring
to. That's what I meant, actually. I'm not talking about lectures that people even know, but about the...
Yeah, but I think we should look at art more than just from a political point of view, though, don't you think? You know, so I think it's a good thing that we're talking about it from different point of views and different angles.
I must say that the answer was in your question, in a way. That something else. I don't think that in terms of methodology, you know, Alors la Chine was a good exhibition. Not to be frank, there was an Africa remix, which was on the other side, an exhibition on the African continent. And I believe in what Yuma says. It will be the worst to continue to think about all these artists in terms of geography. Either you believe that there are multiple questions which artists address to our world, or you don't. And they can be, as Montesquieu, the French philosopher, wrote, le chinois dans la terre, the native means. We cannot forget.
One last quick question.
Bonjour, je suis désolé, en fait, je maîtrise très peu la langue de Shakespeare, donc si ça ne vous dérangerait pas, je ne viens pas poser la question en français. En fait, tout à l'heure, on avait parlé en fait de la collection de l'art chinois dans les grands musées internationaux. On parle la plupart du temps en fait des peintures ou des sculptures. Et en fait, en Chine, en ce moment, il y a une nouvelle vague qui vient de développer, c'est la nouvelle langue de Chine. En fait, c'est une sorte de transcension en fait de l'histoire de la langue de Chine, mais qui est en fait un peu mélangée avec l'art occidental. J'aimerais savoir en fait celui-ci en tant que en fait le conservateur vedette de Pompidou. J'aimerais poser la question à Monsieur Blistène. En fait, qu'est-ce que vous en pensez de cette forme de l'art chinoise? Est-ce que, par exemple, les Européens pourraient en fait les comprendre, c'est-à-dire en fait, est-ce que ce type de l'art peut avoir en fait une sorte de popularité en Europe, dans les pays occidentaux? Par exemple, est-ce qu'ils peuvent être aussi collectionnés dans les grands musées internationaux? Merci.
Je n'ai pas compris, cher monsieur, ce que vous appelez l'encre. What do you mean by l'encre de Chine ou what?
C'est
a new kind of what? Encre de Chine.
Ink.
Ah, ink.
Ink. Yeah.
Ink. Well, it's a new. No, it's well, it's an, yeah. It's a very. No, is it ink? I N K.
Yeah.
Yes.
I N K.
Okay, fine. So you know what happened to me when I was in China? I visited a quite well-known and sorry, I forget the name artist. Who is really a star, I guess, you know, he is developing huge labs in...
His name is Chu Jijie.
Probably. Yes. Why not? No, anyway, and I was surprised with the words, which I found extremely, which I found extremely beautiful. But I didn't know, to be frank, what to think about it. Was it too traditional? Was it like, you know, some kinds of melancholy going back in the past? Then my friend Catherine David went to me, and she was on, she's on perpetual trip, huh? And she was on her way back, and she said to me, you know, I was in the studio of this is fantastic. And I told her, but how could you say that, Catherine, because it looks totally different of what you like. So she explained me about the process of the works, which is not a revival, which is something else, which is as a step on the side, you know, to fix or to try to fix another position. So, sir, in order to answer to your question, I believe in singularity. I don't believe in mainstream. And it seemed to me that such a guy, once again the name?
Jorge.
Yes, was, through what I've seen, which resisted in a way to what I was expected from contemporary art in China, and on the other side, to what Catherine David, who I trust, said to me, that these gentlemen tried really to fix as a singularity, a specific position, and for such a reason, such an artist has to be considered. If you, let's say, if you try once again to give a too global approach of the things, if you try to keep inside categories artists, you know, you will be lost. You will be lost.
It's a fascinating artist, and he's going to have a solo show during the Venice Biennale in one foundation. He has been commissioned a work by a German foundation to map the world. So it's going to be the world remapped from the eyes of China, with all the feelings and all the... I say it's going to be a unique piece, which is going to be gigantic, absolutely amazing work. And he's not just an artist, he's a thinker, he's a teacher, he's a curator, he's shaking the tree all the time. He's really a... from the second generation of Chinese artists, one of the main key figures.
The same with another artist I discovered, despite the fact that I have seen some exhibitions in Paris, Ding Yi. Well, okay, you know all of us, you know, Chinese people, you know Ding Yi, and it seems to me that Ding Yi fixed something which is deeply important, despite the fact that it looks very close to many things which we've done in Europe. But his position, you know, was definitely a singularity.
Especially when once you know that in China making abstraction for his generation was impossible. It was something considered as something against the government. So they couldn't show, couldn't do anything with that. It was absolutely forbidden to do. Here to make an abstract painting, well, it's almost decorative nowadays to make this. There it was a political position against the history, against the ink tradition. So
the same with Russian culture. If you go to Pompidou and if you look at our exhibition, you know, you will see artists who were doing things which were totally forbidden, which have never seen an art magazine, and who've developed in one specific context something which really fixed their singularities.
Yeah, I think, you know, some of the thing was even more interesting. It's not just one work or two works, it's over time, the evolution of his practice as well, and how it's been sort of consistent in terms of positioning himself in terms of that.
I think we have covered a lot. I know it's always frustrating, a talk is just a talk. But thank you very much for all of you to attend. Thank you very much. Uli Singh is going to have a speech very soon at the Pompidou Center, invited by you. So thank you very much to attend. Thank you as well for Dominique and Sylvain Lévy in the back, very discreet. But thank you to all of you in the crowd to have been with us today. Thank you, Bernard Blistène. Thank you. You said it was a vedette. Yes, he's a super vedette curator. And Yoma, we are very happy and very proud that you are joining us in France. Thank you very much. See you soon.
Thank you.